Welcome to Business in Vancouver on Roundhouse Radio 98.3. We are the daily business news program from the Business in Vancouver newspaper and from BIV.com. I'm your host today, Haley Wooden. We're going to be talking about some digital related news. During the renegotiation of the North American Free Trade Agreement, we may see demands to ban countries from requiring businesses to store their data locally. Now, if we do, these demands could actually come up against British Columbia laws. Meghan Sali, the communications manager at OpenMedia, joins me now for some more insight into this. Thanks for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
Let's start with what is required by BC law when it comes to storing data.
Exactly. So right now, what's required by BC law is essentially that if you are a public stakeholder, so if you're the government, you have to store personal information in your custody under your control. So that means in Canada. So that's requiring for the governments. That's not necessarily for businesses or for anybody else, but it's things like personal health information. It's things like communications that you might have with your government around voting or around services. So that thing is really important. We consider it that we keep that personal private data in Canada.
It's really sensitive data, of course, right?
Exactly. And it's one of those things that, especially after the Edward Snowden revelations, you know, people become more and more concerned, in particular with the United States, when we're seeing that type of data transit the U.S. Is it being collected? How is it being stored? Who's taking a look at it? And really what eventually ends up happening with it?
Yeah, who has access to it too. So how might the rules we have in BC actually come up against the United States NAFTA renegotiation priorities?
Yeah, so what we saw the USTR, the United States Trade Representative, say when it laid out its broad priorities was that digital trade was a really big issue area for them. They really want to modernize, as they say, NAFTA, and in particular focus on digital trade. And one of the big asks from some of the big tech companies in particular, but also other companies, is that they place restrictions on data localization is what they call it. So essentially what they want is a blanket rule that says you're not allowed to require the local storage of data. So that's for largely big companies. You know, we're looking at the Googles and the Amazons of the world who say we don't want to have to build, you know, servers in every single country where we're doing business. We want to be able to store that data locally here in the US. And so what we're looking at is a potential situation in which if we don't carve out adequate privacy protections, we could see that law come into our BC law, and also in Nova Scotia as well, come into contact with that in a way that requires us basically to give up our privacy.
So correct me if I'm wrong, we were just talking about how it's mostly applies to governments who have access to really sensitive data. Amazon and Google, I hope, aren't collecting data on my medical records, right? So how would this, you know, if they operate here, which they do, and they have offices here as well, would they be required under current law to have any data storage in BC as it stands?
They're not required under current law to do that. And that's why I think that there's a common sense resolution to this that really is a way out. We saw similar concerns under the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and they actually wrote a fairly flexible law under data localization issues that allowed for the storage and allowed for BC and Nova Scotia in particular to keep that law that required local storage of government data. And so I think that's a question that is one that can easily be solved. You know, for certain businesses, we can certainly see how data localization rules would provide a trade impediment, especially for smaller businesses. You don't want to have to be building, you know, local data storage in every single country where you're doing business. I get that. But certain types of data are extremely sensitive, and we definitely want to see, you know, Canadians' medical data, for example, stored within Canada.
Now, President Trump has, of course, called the Trans-Pacific Partnership an unfair deal to the U.S. They've pulled out of it. But when you look at the United States Trade Representative's list of priorities, those are, of course, very, very similar to what was put forward in advance of the TPP. Do you think we'll see the U.S. really push to not see what the resolution was going to be under the TPP and push for something a little bit more stronger in NAFTA?
Honestly, I think that on the IP and e-commerce, so intellectual property and, you know, e-commerce chapters, we're going to see something very similar to what we saw in the TPP.
Okay.
It's a little bit of a bait and switch, I think, by President Trump. You know, he was really able to say that the Trans-Pacific Partnership was bad because there was certainly, I think, political headwinds were showing that people were not in favor of it. However, when we look at NAFTA, you know, so much of the demands that they're putting in and their priorities are very, very similar to what they had been asking for under the TPP. So really, what we might even see is TPP plus, you know, additional regulations around IP and e-commerce. And we might even see it go further beyond what we had seen in the Trans-Pacific Partnership. And that's certainly of concern to internet freedom groups like OpenMedia.
I'm speaking with Meghan Sali. She's the communications manager at OpenMedia. How common is it to have governments actually store data on foreign servers in foreign countries?
I mean, it's very uncommon. And that's something that I think we've been seeing moving around the world. And this isn't just about government data. It is also about private companies' data. If you look at the European Union, for example, they have very strong data privacy rules around where you're allowed to store data on users as well as a private company. And that's something that is proliferating across the world. And it is tied to concerns around, you know, mass government surveillance, and in particular with the U.S. mass government surveillance. And so I think that, you know, it would be surprising to see governments at this stage not storing their data locally, but increasingly we're actually seeing a move towards requirements to store data locally for private companies as well.
Interesting. So it's possible, I mean, you could have a situation where governments aren't required to host their data in the countries they, you know, do business with, or companies not required to do that, but also not stipulating that there can't be regulations on the part of a partnering company, for example, right?
It could be possible, yeah. And I think that, you know, it bumps up against a couple of different concerns. And I can see both sides of the story here. I mean, as we already spoke about, as a business, it would be very difficult, especially as a small business and an internet-based business, to store your data in every single country, potentially where you had customers. However, I mean, I also understand the concerns of customers who are sharing personal private data with many of these companies and potentially saying, where does that data end up? That makes a lot of sense as well. And then there's a third factor when we're thinking about, you know, here in Canada, we generally consider our government to be responsive to the needs of people. But if we look at more repressive regimes around the world, there's actually an argument that data localization rules that require the local storage of data are putting those citizens at risk. You know, if repressive regimes are storing all that data locally, that means that they have access to all that information on people, including from private companies. So companies like Google, potentially in places like Russia and China, would maybe not want to store their data in that country because it makes it vulnerable to their own governments. So it's certainly a thorny issue.
Interesting. And I don't want to call the U.S. a repressive regime. That's not where I'm going with this. But in theory, if Canadian governments or businesses were required to have servers in the U.S., if they wanted access to that data, it could be subject to U.S. law. And potentially there could be a situation where they don't get access. Is that a possibility?
I mean, certainly. And this is one of the big, this concern essentially arose with concerns of the Patriot Act, and then, you know, really inflated when we started to hear Edward Snowden's revelations around how data was being stored and collected in the U.S. So this isn't a new concern. And, you know, it is a concern that many different countries have about the United States and the way that they store data and the amount of internet traffic that frankly is routed through the U.S. We know now that they're, you know, collecting essentially all of that data and storing it. And so I think that there are very reasonable questions to be asked by governments and by companies about what happens and where that data ends up.
Now, we're talking a little bit about the NSA and sort of the reach of the United States' eyes, so to speak. Even if we collect or store data locally here in Canada, realistically, is it still vulnerable to access from foreign states?
I mean, that's a tough one because we go down a rabbit hole. And one of the things that we talk about a lot at Open Media is the fact that as Canadians, and this is just one example, even if we require the local storage of data, when your data is in transit, so when you're using the internet, say I'm sitting here in Vancouver and I'm sending an email to you in Vancouver as well, my internet traffic may boomerang through Seattle. It may go through Tacoma. Mm-hmm. It may actually travel through the United States. And in that transit, it's potential vulnerable to U.S. surveillance. So there are bigger questions, and this is not a silver bullet. You know, these types of data localization rules are not going to make our data, you know, completely safe or invulnerable to prying eyes, but they're common sense regulations that I think that we should have in place.
Beyond what we've been discussing, is there anything else you or Open Media would like to see when it comes to securing the privacy of Canadians?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I think that there's a lot of work to be done within Canada as well. You know, we're currently seeing Bill C-59, which is the update to Bill C-51, you know, Canada's national spying legislation, essentially. And when the current government updated that, you know, on the Harper government's heels, we saw that one particular area where they actually didn't pay very close attention and where they didn't listen to the concerns of Canadians was on information sharing, and in particular, information sharing with the U.S. So we share vast amounts of information willingly with the U.S. governments. Canadians, you know, don't necessarily even know that their information has been shared. And that type of information, depending on what it is, can be really damaging to them. And we've seen cases from, you know, everything from people trying to cross the border and having issues of mental health brought up. So, you know, they're having their health records shared. You know, these types of things can be really damaging to a person's life. And so that's one of the issues that we'd really like to see our own government take control of and say, we have work to do in protecting the privacy of Canadians.
What's your sense in terms of this review, where it's going to go? Do you think we'll see some more protections come online, or will we see things continue to go as they have been going?
I mean, Bill C-59 was a good step in the right direction. There was certainly quite a lot of important updates that were made to the legislation and, you know, like loopholes that were closed mm-hmm. that were introduced by C-51. But there is more to be done. And I think that the Canadian government is not going to stop hearing about it. This is, you know, something people are hearing about every single day in the news now. It's something that we're having to confront more and more. So I think that, you know, without really strong updates and another round of strong updates addressing in particular issues like information sharing, you know, they're not going to get a reprieve from the Canadian public.
There you go. Well, certainly we are in the age of sharing information and digitization and access really to information, whether we want certain types of information to be accessed or not. So protections are important. Thanks for joining the show today, Meghan.
Thanks for having me.
That's Meghan Sali. She is the communications manager at OpenMedia. You're listening to Business in Vancouver on Roundhouse Radio 98.3. I'm Haley Wooden. We'll be back after this.